Hello, thank you very much, Lord Maurice, for being with us today. I just want to start by asking the hot topic. What do you think, what is your reaction against Turkish invasion attack on northern east Syria?
Well, my first reaction is that I'm disgusted. It's a terrible event in contemporary history. The second reaction is that I'm very afraid for the Kurdish people in the North Syria Federation, but I'm also concerned for the Yazidis, for the Turkmen, for the Syriac Christians. I was there 2 weeks ago, so I saw how the council systems work. I spoke to the Christians, I spoke to Turkmen, Yazidis, as well as Kurds, as well as Sunni Arabs who were really participating in the council system. So I see this as a really terrible, merciless attack by Turkey on the most remarkable example of contemporary democratic experiment that I know of.
As you said, you just came back from the region 2 weeks
yeah.
ago, and you were with a delegation, you had a lot of meeting with people, you saw with your own eyes the system, the democratic autonomy there, how they work, how they organize. So can you tell us a bit more about your observations about North and East Syria or Rojava?
Yeah, so it's built on a different model, which is based on a very strong local democracy. It's almost like a parish system, a very small area where they have assemblies sometimes every 2 weeks, sometimes every month, and they elect committees from there, which have to have a male chair and a female chair. That's how the system works. It has to be a third women to be quorate, and essentially they govern themselves. They sort out their education, they sort out their housing. And it's based on a strong democracy with a common peaceful coexistence with other communities. So it's a very pluralist area. We tend to forget this. There's all these different communities. So it began as a Kurdish idea, but it grew. And so with the SDF winning all the way to Raqqa, all the way down south to Raqqa, it came across huge Sunni Arab areas. And I saw also evidence of women participating in that, tribal elders participating in that. So in this area, this is based on democracy, it's based on equality between people, it's based on a pluralism between the communities. It's a genuine, I call it a miracle, that this could happen in that place. So what Turkey is doing is asserting a singular notion of violence and the nation state in order to destroy democracy on its borders, which of course terrorism.
As Trump said, Kurds fought their own land, but what we saw, it wasn't only serving for their own people, because they get out of that as well. Yeah. And it was like in Raqqa, in Deir ez-Zor. So what is your comment about Trump's comment that Kurds only fought for their own land and they didn't help them in Normandy or Second World War?
Yeah, well, Trump in this case has finally revealed himself as a genuine idiot. He really doesn't understand what he's doing, and that I think is also clear to Republicans. I saw reports of really right-wing Republicans say, what are you talking about? But the reality is that people don't really know what's been going on in northern Syria. They don't know about the council system, they don't know about the pluralism. They tend to view it as an ethnic or a religious war. So while Kurds really do know what's at stake in this area, I think that there's been a very big problem with the world understanding what's going on.
And since the attacks have started, there is a huge reactions from all around the world. There is no one is happy about what Turkey is trying to do, invading Syria. However, still the attacks continues. So how do you read the situation at the moment?
The way I read the situation is that the EU cannot respond, because even yesterday Erdogan said, okay, I'll release all the Islamists into Europe, and Europe is terrified of this arrival of a million Islamists who are being held in Turkey. So the EU condemns it but can't do anything. The United States has walked away. I just think it's the responsibility of Britain. to stay because we're a NATO ally. If there were 100 British troops on the ground, that would mean that Turkey could not continue with the invasion because it would be an attack on a NATO partner. So I really think that it's Britain's role to do that and support a small democracy that's being besieged. But nothing is happening. All this condemnation is coming in, but you notice that nothing is being done.
Practically.
Yeah, so that is the dilemma. What we are witnessing is ethnic cleansing at the least. Mass murder certainly is on its way. It could be that the Kurds of Syria will be no more in 2 months, that they will all be expelled. These are the realities, and we just sit there and watch. That's what I meant when I said that it's disgusting.
As you must be aware, what happened in Afrin just a year ago. So, linking with that, what you just said, the danger of ethnic cleansing and changing the demography of the region. Can you comment a bit more? Is that possible? Will the world allow this?
Well, this is likely. And we saw what happened in Afrin. So just to recapitulate what happened in Afrin. What happened in Afrin is the Turks had 56 consecutive days of bombing. And essentially, the Kurds were sitting ducks because they have no air force. There's no protection. Neither have they got anti-aircraft weapons. So after 56 days, they put in the Islamist militias. And I have evidence which I can show you. I'm in touch with the resistance in Afrin, and they send me the destruction of cemeteries, the removal of people's homes, mass evidence of rape. This is what happened in Afrin: is that the Kurds were expelled from a place. There's archaeological evidence that they've been living in Afrin for 3,000 years. Yeah. You know, this is the decimation of their ancestral home, as well as any evidence that they lived there. That's the thing with the cemeteries and the bulldozing of Kurdish culture. So we know what happened in Afrin, and there is no reason to think that what happened in Afrin will not happen now in the rest of Kurdish Syria. We have been warned, we know what's going to happen. So there is a terrible danger, but it's the likely reality that this is what we're witnessing. We're already seeing evidence of it coming in from the invasion. So that's the reality that we have to face.
From that, coming to British government, Turkish Prime Minister yesterday said that British government has offered help in this operation, in these attacks. But what we see, what we saw in House of Lords, in House of Commons, there is quite huge reaction against these invasion attacks. And also Dominic Raab, the foreign minister, yesterday said that they have spoken to Turkey once again, and they have told them that these attacks must stop. So where does British government stand in all this situation?
Well, unfortunately, the British government is a bit distracted at the moment with Brexit, so that kind of dominates everything. But I did find a quote from Boris Johnson from 2014, when this was at the time of Kobani, you know, in September, where he said that we must do everything we can to support the Kurds. So I'm just letting you know that that's a quote that's out there. And my understanding is that the British government feels quite humiliated by how Trump behaved. There was no consultation. It was very humiliating because British special forces and air forces worked with the SDF over these years. There are existing relationships there. So I note also that the American military, very unusually, has let it be known that it thinks this is terrible, what's going on. So for the British government is certainly not supporting Turkey, as far as I know. Nothing that I have in the conversations that I've had would indicate that. But they are confused about what to do. Turkey is a NATO ally. It's a, quote, moderate Muslim nation. And they don't have the confidence to act independently of the United States. And as I mentioned, the EU is very stuck. It can't move because it's terrified of the refugees. So in many ways, Britain is in a very good position to act, but it can't act. But as it stands, I know of no cooperation between Britain and Turkey on this. It's only been opposed to it.
And when we look at the reaction, most of the reaction is about how Kurds fought against ISIS. This is the only reaction they are talking about. Do you think this is fair on Kurds, like not seeing what kind of system they are creating, is just talking about fighting against ISIS?
I understand. So this is a long-standing conversation that we've had and we've had with other people. People simply do not know about this democratic system. Don't imagine that they do. So there's no real knowledge of it. And when you explain it to them, it sounds mysterious and a bit far-fetched. So they're completely understanding it through the frame that the Kurds sacrificed their lives to fight ISIS. ISIS was a common enemy, and we worked together with them. So that's a very good beginning of this conversation. And what I hope and I pray is that along the road now, people begin to understand what kind of politics has been created there and how we can learn from that and support that.
Mm-hmm. And what kind of risk do you see as an outcome of these invasion attacks for the world?
Well, the first is the resurrection of Islamism. Is that ISIS was genuinely fought. I was in Al-Hor camp 2 weeks ago, where the remnant of the Caliphate army is held, and they're still running up the ISIS flag at night. They're still killing women who take off the chador. They're still fully operational. But don't forget that Turkey also supports al-Nusra and al-Qaeda, who you know, the differences
between
them.
A lot different.
It's just a name. Between them are very, very small. Mm-hmm. So the first is you have the resurrection of Islamism. The second terrible thing that happens is that the Kurds are expelled from their homelands and they are replaced by Sunni Arab Islamists who never lived there. So this is the demographic change of the region. Those are the fundamental risks that it makes permanent the presence of Islamist forces on the Turkish border, and that therefore the war will never end. It's a permanent institutionalization of a violent conflict, which was going so far to being resolved through the system of democratic confederalism and self-government.
Thank you. And lastly, what is the solution? How can this whole problem to be solved? Like, for example, maybe recognition of democratic autonomy in northern East Syria. So what do you think, how this problem can be solved?
Well, there's got to be a change in the Adana process, which excluded any recognition of the Syrian Kurds of the Northern Confederation of Syria. So some recognition, a recognition of the area. I think that the system developed in that area allows all the different communities of Syria to live together peacefully. So some form of federal constitution would come out of this. It would give a guarantee that the Alawites can live. It's a system of non-domination, so no one single community dominates. So the actual model developed in Rojava is a very, very good model for all of Syria. However, we're very far from that right now. So essentially what's got to happen is that Turkey have got to be stopped. All pressure on Trump to recognize the mistake he made and to reintroduce American troops. I think there should be political work here in Britain to argue for the presence of British troops and British special forces in that area so that this diabolical and terrible act by Turkey can be stopped. That's the first priority.
Thank you very much for all your comments, Lord Maurice.
And real solidarity with you and with the people in Syria.
Thank you.